all your pressure, your way out. The community cop. It's a blessing to see your face today. Welcome once again to another edition of Community Cop. My name is Noel, leader, one of the co-founder members of 100 Blacks in Law Enforcement Who Care. And I'm here today with my co-host, Michael Graves, a.k.a. Big Mike.
Namaste.
As is customary, we like to open up a broadcast with a history piece. History is very important to Community Cop. Our first history piece, we want to acknowledge the birthday of ancestor Martin Luther King, who was born on 1/15/1929. Michael, what are your thoughts on Martin Luther King?
Well, certainly he was truly the voice and the epicenter of the civil rights movement. He was the voice that white America listened to and gravitated towards. There were many leaders in that era, but he became the epicenter of the civil rights movement. Certainly, Dr. King, Georgia born and bred, went to Morehouse. He went to Montgomery, Alabama, where he cut his teeth as the pastor of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. And certainly at around that time, you know, early on, what happened with Rosa Parks being thrown off of a bus elevated him because he was a part of the Montgomery Improvement Association, which they formed to fight the segregation on a bus and brought him the national attention. But he proved himself to be a warrior, truly a modern day Prince of Peace. Dr. King did so much for our people and sacrificed. He typifies what true sacrifice is, the very things that he did. So long live his spirit. A good brother did just so much for so many. And we don't really appreciate him as much as we should because he did so much for our people. And that's why the only federal holiday towards a black person was given to somebody that wasn't a president of the United States, but he was the moral center of what America strives to be, or some in America strive to be, but certainly with recent developments, some reject.
All right, and then we have the birthday of another ancestor, great ancestor, the great boxing hero, legend, and activist, Muhammad Ali, whose birthday was on January 17th, 1942.
Yes, and oh man, if you saw him when he fought, certainly we felt we was in the ring. When Ali was in the ring, we felt every blow. And when he threw his hands up after victory, we threw our hands up while we were watching him. He was just that good, the greatest heavyweight of all time. I wouldn't say the greatest boxer of all time. I think that's Sugar Ray Robinson, but certainly the greatest heavyweight champion of all time. And the stance he took was so heroic, not to step forward and to be used as a puppet for the world to participate in the Vietnam War was heroic on his part. And certainly he made that oft-quoted statement Vietnamese never called me nigga. And so that was his way of saying that people of color on the planet was not the enemy. And he said, and he made it crystal clear during many press conferences that it was the white man that's putting a club over his head. It was the white man that is shooting down and hanging out people. It's the white man that's creating segregation. It's the white man that's doing all these things in the world and assassinations all over the world. So he felt that Vietnamese was not his enemy, and he was not going to fight those who did not fight with us. And certainly I would be remiss. You cannot mention Muhammad Ali without mentioning the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who led that organization, who imposed these nationalistic values on Muhammad Ali, on so many leaders. I was getting ready to say Dr. Khalid, which we'll get to later, but certainly the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, and certainly Dr. Khalid and so many others. You know, you cannot talk about them without mentioning the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who led that organization.
And it's great that you mentioned the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, because out of all of our leaders, out of all of our heroes, he's the least mentioned, although he contributed so much to our people in this country. Also, you wanted to talk about Special Field Order number 15, whose date was on January 16, 1865. To those who don't know, this is the 40 acre and a mule promise that we received. Talk about that Special Field Order 15, Michael.
Yeah, this some people think that order actually came from President Abraham Lincoln. It didn't. It came from William Tecumseh Sherman, who was a general. And as he was making his way blazing across the South, he had so many enslaved Africans as he went and was freeing them from various plantations, and they were following him. He started taking land away from Southern whites, major plantations, and putting them on it, telling them that they could actually keep that land, and which was overturned later by Andrew Johnson, who was the first president to be impeached. But and he hated black people. He was a vicious president who came after Lincoln, after the Lincoln assassination. So he overturned Special Field Order 15, but certainly you have to give some credit to William Tecumseh Sherman for at least attempting to give some black folks land, which is the basis of independence.
All right. And last, saving the best for last, I'm going to say, is the birthday of Minister Khalid Muhammad, may peace be upon him and the other ones as well, whose birthday was on November 12, 1948.
Well, I have to say that when I think of him, it just warms the soul, because he was a personal friend. And I know he was friends with you also, Noel. And
yes,
he
sir.
Spoke of you. He spoke of you in favorable terms. I would just say that I have so many great memories, some that I cannot share with the public, because these were personal conversations. But I will tell you this, I knew something was wrong with Dr. Khalid, because I knew his spirit, and his spirit took hold of any room that he was in. He was just that level of seriousness and so sincere and everything. And as I sat next to him in Harlem at the Armory, during the men's only meetings, which preceded the Million Man March, when we were there in Harlem, I knew something was wrong, and I actually turned to him and I said, Dr. Khalid, I said, brother, you know, are you okay? And he said, you know, we'll see, you know, I'm okay, but we'll see. So I knew that, you know, things were going on at that time. And I'll just say that all the memories were positive. I have not met anybody more sincere and more truthful to his word than Dr. Khalid Abdul-Muhammad. When he said it, he meant it. And I know you probably want to share some memories of Dr. Khalid, but I can tell you, the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was internalized in Dr. Khalid. Through and through, he believed in those teachings and he lived by it and just was so sincere. And if I had to wrap it up in one word, at the risk of repeating myself, the brother was sincere.
Yes, and yes, I was fortunate to have known Mr. Khalid Muhammad when he was a representative of Mosque Number 7 in Harlem, and I was working at the 28th right. Precinct. We had many interactions, and sincerity, soldier, nationalist, Mr. Khalid Muhammad loved Black people. And that's one of the reasons I believe that there was a conspiracy to neutralize him first out of the Nation of Islam, and then off of the planet Earth, because he had an attraction to the most significant segment of Black society, which is the youth. He had, you know, he attracted the youth. The youth loved him. He was articulate. He was very, very intelligent, and he had heart. And he said what he meant, and he meant what he said. And young people gravitated towards that more than most of the leaders. They gravitated because they noted the sincerity in his voice and the love for his people. Quick story I'll share, you know, actually came from Brother Melchizedek, who was one of the members of the Fruit of Islam and the Nation of Islam years ago. He talked about a story when Minister Khalid Muhammad had went to the court to support Shamrock Nelson, who was accused of killing a member of the Hasidic community during the so-called Brooklyn riots. Limrock Nelson. And, you know, the courtroom was filled with members of the Hasidic community, where our brother Limrock had very few supporters. So Minister Khalid went to the courtroom, Brooklyn Court, to support him. And when members of the Hasidic, who was there by the hundreds, seen Minister Khalid, they began to chant, "We want Khalid, we want Khalid," in a negative way. They wanted to bring harm to Minister Khalid Muhammad. Yes. And he had some choice words back to them, because even though he might have been with about six or seven brothers and he was outnumbered by hundreds, he let them know how they felt about him as well. And when he was leaving the courtroom, the brother said to Minister Khalid, Khalid, they out there and they're angry. He said, "There's hundreds of them out there. You know, what do you want to do, brother?" Minister Khalid, he said, Minister Khalid looked at him and said, "Kill as many as you can and die." That was his position. Was 100% man. He said, "Listen, I'm walking out these courtroom doors, and if they want to bring harm to us, to me, kill as many as you can and die." You know, and that's
a warrior.
Yes, sir, that's a warrior. And that's the warrior nature of Mr. Khalid Muhammad. And even when he wanted to have the Mean Youth March in Harlem, and white supremacist, white racist, Mayor Giuliani at the time, wanted to deny him and his organization of their constitutional rights to meet. He said, "Listen, we applied for a permit, but whether we get one or not, we're marching." You know, and that's the heart and the spirit and the energy of Minister Khalid Muhammad that this government was afraid of. And as I said, the attraction he had to young Black men in particular is why they wanted to, why they conspired to neutralize him and to silence him. But you know, we'll always remember one of the great warriors our community and the Nation of Islam ever produced, and that's the great warrior, Minister Khalid Abdul Muhammad. May peace be upon him.
Yes, sir. And again, it was illegal, and you can compare that to present day events that are going on for the Congress, which President-elect Biden called the citadel of liberty and justice. He talked about the Capitol building. Well, it was in that building where they did a 99-0 vote against Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad, where they voted to silence a person who was exercising his First Amendment rights. Now, irrespective of what you believe about his speech that he made at King College, It was his speech. Now, he said things about religion, things about Jewish people, things about the Pope. And instead of just respecting his words, whether they be true or lie, whatever person says, you weigh it. You weigh it on the scales of justice and the scales of truth, whether it's right or wrong. But they went with a bill of attainder, which is illegal. It is against Article 1, Section 3, Section 9, Clause 3 of the Constitution, which forbids that, an august body, of making that type of declaration without a hearing. So when you silence a person like that, that's saying that person is open game for death. That's why it's never done. That's why American law, which is based on British law forbidden it, and that's why they put it in the Constitution to forbid that there, because if they do that, anytime they want to, they can go with a vote like that, and now you'll be open game for anybody that chooses to kill you. They're telling you up front, there will be no investigation, there will be no follow-up. That's why when Minister Khalid Abdul Muhammad was taken from us, you don't see a real follow-up, a real investigation, and the circumstances still today are murky and questionable at best.
Right, and then in closing, I'd just like to say, and I thank you for that, Michael, when you talk about them censoring him to silence him, you know, what was so unusual about it is that he was a civilian. And when you think about the United States of America, you can think of hundreds of individuals who may say certain things that others find objectionable, that others may be offended by. So for the government, the highest levels of government, to have a discussion in a meeting and take a vote about a civilian should have raised some serious questions amongst our community. What was Minister Khalid Muhammad saying that was so horrible, which caused them to do this? And the truth of the matter is, as I stated, he was appealing to Black people. He was unapologetically critical of this government, of the enemies of our elevation, those who profit off our disenfranchisement, our oppression. He was critical of those individuals. And that is why they came out against him, because he had the ear of the youth. You know, he had the ear of the young. And that young energy, that young anger, that bravado that that occurs amongst young peoples, and particularly young Black men, is why they feared Minister Khalid Muhammad and did what they did. You know, it's not as much what he was saying, even though they found objection to that, but he was a true leader and had the ability to galvanize and organize people, and that's what he was doing, and that's what they feared. As long as you just talk strong, and they may object to what you said, but there's no attraction, there's no following, they may not move on you, but Minister Khalid Muhammad was moving in that direction. He had that attraction. And not only those young men in the streets, where we're talking about individuals they classify as gang members, but he was getting invitations to speak to colleges around the nation, around the country, and even in other countries. The intellectual members, the youth of our community, had an appeal for Minister Khalid Muhammad, and that is what they feared most, is the appeal that he had. And the reason why he had that appeal, because his earnest, you know, they sensed the earnesty and the honesty and the integrity whenever he spoke. And he spoke with such awesome power. And you can catch some of his videos on YouTube if you just pull them up. But, you know, any last words as it relates to Minister Khalid Muhammad?
I end with what I began with. He is the most sincere person that you ever will meet. He meant what he said, and I have to just repeat something you said. The love he has for Black people was incredible.
Right. All right. All right. So that's our history portion. We want to go straight ahead. We want to, before we talk about, you know, the talk of the nation right now, we want to just do some, end up some old news. Justin Volpe, some of you may remember, he's a white police officer of the 70th Precinct who has sodomized Abner Louima in the 70th Precinct Station House. He was ultimately arrested and convicted and sentenced to a long prison term. Well, you know, I guess he now had completed the mandatory amount of time he has to do, and he's making appeal for early release. I believe I heard he had COVID-19, and he's trying to get off on the sympathy clause. But Michael, remind our viewing audience about Justin Volpe, police officer Justin Volpe, as well as his appeal for early release.
Justin Volpe, along with several other police officers, held down, well, beat down several times, but held him down and actually took a stick and rammed it up Abner Louima's rectum and then tried to deny it. And they came out with salacious stories about this was just gay activity because the club that that they were in did have a gay night. So they tried to make up a story. So he was lying and had to, at some point, confess because he was pressured by the police officers to at least fall on the sword so that they could be let off. But in any event, several of them got various amounts of time, but he got 30-some-odd years. He's only did 21 years out of a 30-plus year sentence. And so he's trying to get off on sympathy, saying he has COVID. Well, there's a whole lot of people that has COVID-19 that's locked up all over the country. They will not get an early release because of COVID, and neither should he.
All right, we'll keep our viewing audience apprised of whether or not he actually is, but I concur with you that he doesn't. Definitely, when you look at the ghastly deed, the diabolical, I haven't used that word in a while, a thing that he did to a civilian inside of a police station house, you know, in my humble opinion, he did so much damage, not only to that individual, but to the profession, that he definitely doesn't deserve any consideration for early release. All right, as many of you may remember, last Wednesday, thousands and thousands of Trump supporters stormed the Capitol building after attending a rally where our president was the primary speaker. President Trump encouraged them to go down to the Capitol building because he knew the Senate and the House were voting, doing the Electoral College vote to announce who won the presidency. And President Trump, of course, he has articulated since Election Day his refusal to accept the ultimate vote of the electorate and picking President Biden. So after he encouraged them to go to the Capitol building, they stormed it. Five individuals was killed, and Michael was the first, in my eyes, to break the breaking news that a police officer was also killed on that date, and it was very silent, surprisingly. But since then, there's been a lot of flack. There's investigations. There's been the FBI have arrested over 170 individuals across the nation for their participation in this particular riot. They so far allegedly are going to be charged with some very extreme charges, from sedition, conspiracy, felony murder, criminal trespass, et cetera, et cetera. So right throughout the nation, there is an attempt to identify, to look at all of the video footage of that particular day and to identify each members that was there. Mike, before I get on any specifics regarding some police officers' involvement and firemen and et cetera, et cetera, what are your opinion as we stand today in regards to the investigation to identify those individuals who participated in this riot?
Well, interestingly, from the outset, the only reason why there will be any type of investigation is because of the FBI and the fact that a police officer, Officer Sicknick, was killed. Now, they tried to keep that hidden for a while. They actually tried to suppress that he was dead. So after they could not keep that information from the public, they mentioned it, but there has been no outcry. I'm gonna say that again, Noel, because I think it bears repeating.
Yes,
sir. There has been no outcry. Now tell me the words that the PBA has said, Noel. What has the PBA said about it?
Nothing.
What has the FOP said about it?
Absolutely nothing.
What is the thin blue line said about it?
Nothing.
What has Blue Lives Matter said about it?
Absolutely nothing.
But these are the premier unions that speak every time a cop kills a black man, a woman, or a child unarmed, not in the commission of a crime. They find a way to justify that. Now, when a black officer is killed by a white officer, they go radio silent, and though the few that do speak, find a way to justify that. Now, how do they justify a white cop being killed in a Capitol building, defending elected officials, and they don't say anything about it? Could it be, now I'm asking you this rhetorically, could it be that all of those unions, as prominent as they are, could it be that they are in line with Trump supporters? Could it be that they're in line with seditionists? Yes, insurrectionists, seditionists, treasonous, if that's a word, is treasonous a word? Or will those that act out treason, put it yes, that sir. Way. So could it be that they're in line with them, that they're in lockstep with them, that they're a part of these militias and organizations? Could it be that? Could that dictate their silence at this time? And I'm asking you that rhetorically.
Yes, and I would say they're not only in line with those who stormed the Capitol building, they not only sympathize with those who stormed the Capitol building and are responsible for the death of the officer that was present, are responsible for the damage that were that occurred inside of the Capitol building, are responsible for the intimidation of members of the House and the Senate, are responsible for stopping government procedures from going on. As we stated, they were attempting to count the electoral vote of a very important election. They not only are sympathizers of all of that, but it has come out now that off-duty police officers and firemen from all over the country participated in what happened. So they were actually there. So perhaps some of their silence is not only philosophical, but it's self-serving, because they realize that there are probably some images of many of their members that took part in some of the debauchery. As a matter of fact, there's some officers who said that individuals stormed the buildings who had a Black Lives Matter signed, and it's so comical that the officer stated when he was telling them to get back, they told him, "No, listen, man, we're doing this for you," and then punched him in the face, which he thought was the epitome of hypocrisy. So there's not only a philosophical alignment with these police unions, these police agencies and departments, with the individuals who rioted, but they were participating. Some of their members were participating. And so far, officers from Seattle, Texas, Pennsylvania, New Hampshire, and New York City are under investigation by the Federal Bureau of Investigation for their involvement and possible criminal actions taken against them, you know, for what they did.
Right, and I'm glad you mentioned police departments, because I mentioned unions. Right. You haven't heard a peep from the Capitol Police. You haven't heard anything from U.S. Marshals. You haven't heard anything from sheriff departments all over the country. You haven't heard anything from attorney generals from all over the country. You haven't heard anything from military personnel. This police officer was former military. So the Department of Defense and all veterans of foreign wars should be on board with this.
That's right.
Why is it so strangely silent from the law enforcement community? Now, this police officer, Sicknick, that was killed, was a supporter of Donald Trump. He was a supporter and was still killed. He was trying to defend the Capitol building and was subsequently beat to death with a fire extinguisher. There has been nothing of record from all of these various law enforcement agencies, the unions, legal attorney generals, American Bar, the National Bar, all of these organizations, you haven't heard a word. So are they waiting for him to be put in the ground first? I mean, what are they waiting for? I think it's, as you said, it's self-serving because they know that first responders all over the country was involved in this, was knee-deep involved in sedition. Mm. And that's some serious stuff. And that's sedition against a foreign government, sedition against the American government and the lawmakers of this country.
Facts. And one of the, some of the outrageous, one of the most outrageous points to substantiate what we're saying and what the FBI is saying is not only did what their officers, civilian officers involved in the crowd amongst the rioters, not only were the officers who were actually rioting and attacking other police officers who they claim they support, but there were officers in uniform who were complicit. Some officers were allowing the crowd to enter the building. Some officers were directing the crowd, and this is on video, as to inside of the building, where they should go inside of the building. Some of the officers were clapping as the individuals were trespassing on government property, destroying government property, invading government property. And since some officers took selfies as if they were comrades with That's members right. that were involved in this criminal act. So we have officers in civilian clothes who are off duty, who were involved in this in these criminal acts, and we have officers that were on duty in uniform who were involved. So perhaps, not only were they in line with what the rioters were doing and what the rioters were saying, but they were involved in what they were doing and what they were saying. And I think it's the epitome of outrage as a law enforcement professional when you look at the actions of some of these police officers. The video where you see the young rioter who was shot and killed, when you look at the video before the officer was forced to use deadly physical force against her, the crowd has said to the police officers, listen, we with you, we for you, we're going to give you a pathway to move out the way because we're going through them doors. And the officers actually left. The officers actually left. They have a responsibility and a duty to protect the members of the Congress and members of the Senate that were on the other side of those doors. They have a responsibility as law enforcement officers to do their duty. And sometimes we have to put our lives on the line. We understand that when we put on a uniform. But members of this particular crowd said to the police officers, if you watch the video, listen, we're on your side. We don't want to hurt you. You know, we want to get in there. So we're going to give a pathway for you guys to leave. And then the officers, with their tail between their legs, simply left. One of the most outrageous things that I've seen as a law enforcement professional in my life. So there's complicity, and those officers should be terminated because members, you know, everybody knows when you enter these government buildings, there's a scanner. You know, you have to be scanned. They have to make certain that you don't have any weapons on you or any devices on you. But these individuals just bombarded their way into this building. None of them was scanned. You don't know what kind of weapons they had. You don't know if they had a bomb, but these officers just stepped aside and allowed them to almost enter, you know, allow them to enter the house, you know, of Congress and the Senate. And so those police officers' actions, you know, I'm pretty certain when this investigation unfolds that there's going to be a lot of culpability of those officers that were there. So to answer your question, Michael, real quick, not only were there sympathizers, but they were participants in what happened, law enforcement officers.
Okay, here's what. This Lieutenant Colonel.
Yes, sir.
Who was there, his name is Larry Rendell Brock Jr. He is a Lieutenant Colonel in the Air Force, retired. And he said he was arrested in Texas, mm-hmm. I think yesterday. He was arrested in Texas. He had on a Kevlar helmet, a flak jacket, military patches, and he had flex cuffs. Now, they asked him today, what was the flex cuffs for? Was he going to make Nancy Pelosi and others his prisoners? Do you know what he said, Noel? He said he picked up those flex cuffs off the floor. So Casper the Friendly Ghost brought him in. And he picked him up off the floor. They asked him, did he go into one of the officers, was it Pelosi or was it Clyburn? He said no, but they got the footage showing him go in the office. So they got him lying.
Right, which
so
is a crime.
So they're acting as if, yeah, now they act, you can't lie to a federal officer. So they say, this is not me talking, they say it's going to be difficult to hit them with the proper charges. So I'm going to help them out. I think me and you together can help them out, Noel.
Yes, sir.
So let's go first. Is conspiracy a charge?
Yes, sir.
Because conspiracy only requires two or more.
Yes,
so
sir.
You're saying that conspiracy is a charge?
It's a charge very frequently charged with Black and Latino members in the hood.
Okay. How about riot? Is that a charge? Riot?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How about inciting a riot?
Yes,
sir. Is
that
a charge?
That's there as well. I seen it.
You saying that's on the books already?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What about illegal entry? Is that on the books?
Yes, that's on the books.
As a matter of fact, it's so bad that in New York City, you can be arrested going to see a friend. If your friend is in the projects, you know they had that thing going on with NYPD where they was arresting people. If you was in that building and they caught you without an ID card, they could lock you up.
They called trespassing.
And you was going to see family or friends.
They said you were trespassing, criminal trespassing.
Exactly. So it's safe to say that illegal entry is a charge in a federal building.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what about felony murder? Is that a charge?
Yes, sir.
Is it on the books already?
Yes, sir.
So now I ask you again, why are they making it seem it's difficult to charge these people, because some of the people didn't even know and didn't realize they was inside the building. So they were outside the building, and then they don't realize that they in the building. Everybody that's in that building is eligible for them charges that you agreed are on the books already.
Exactly.
So why is it so difficult, and certainly this is rhetorical, why is it so difficult to figure out and got to verify with film footage and all these other things and questions and a rigorous investigation to find out what to charge them with just the things that I mentioned? And I didn't mention everything. I just mentioned some basic things. They're on the books already.
Right. And it's so amusing, Michael, because some of those charges that you named, all they have to do is be inside the Capitol building and they can be charged, because their entry was not legal. You know, as I stated earlier in the program, everyone knows that before you go into the Capitol building, you have to be screened. It's not voluntary. If you don't want to be screened, you can't enter. They literally pushed the officers. It's on video. They've literally pushed the legal representatives who have the authority to screen people, to stop people from entering. They literally pushed them aside and forced themselves into the building. That alone is a criminal charge. So anybody who was present inside of the building can be charged just by merely being present by the manner by which they entered the building, you know, and that's not even debatable. So if anyone suggests, especially as a prosecutor, that there's any difficulty in getting prosecutions for these individuals who participate in this riot, that's a joke, and that is tantamount to a revelation that perhaps these prosecutors are also complicit with the rioters, the philosophy and the actual activity of the rioters, as opposed to being prosecutors, professional prosecutors who prosecute prosecute just solely basis on the law and the actions of the individuals involved. And you named the linear charges, Michael, but some of us may remember that Donald Trump on the 26th of June in 2020 signed an executive order making a mandatory 10-year sentence for any violence against a government building, destruction of federal property, monuments, or statue. Now, he meant it when he signed it against the Black Lives Matter movement. But lo and behold, they have another tool that they can utilize for the individuals who did destruction to this, Capitol building. And it's a mandatory, under his executive order, it's a mandatory 10-year sentence. So,
and that's against black people, not so much Black Lives Matter, but black people.
Exactly. And that's what it was intended for.
They at one time, the FBI, under Obama, was talking about black identity extremists.
Right.
Well, as the world turns, the FBI said that the greatest threat to national security is white, right-wing extremists. But they're not investigating them. Are they going to investigate that retired lieutenant colonel who came in there with a Kevlar helmet and a flak jacket on, who claims he picked up those flex cups, he found them on the floor? Are they going to investigate him in Texas and find out who he's associated with? That's what the FBI is supposed to do.
Right.
Are they going to investigate all these individuals and build a web and find out who all these associations are? That's my question. Now, it was interesting that you said President Trump put an executive order out on how to deal with subversives, how to deal with people engaged in sedition. Let me turn the question around another way.
Mm-hmm.
We just talked about people that entered the Capitol building.
Right.
Let's talk about those that didn't. And these names are names that are familiar to you. What about President Donald Trump? What about former mayor, former federal prosecutor, Rudolph Giuliani? What about Donald Trump Jr.? Did they incite people to riot? They did not go into the Capitol building.
Right.
No footage shows them. They were outside at the Lincoln Monument earlier in the park, inciting people, whipping them up into a frenzy. And you had Donald Trump Jr. talking about fighting, that you got to use force, you can't come in soft, you got to come in hard, you got to fight. You had Giuliani talking about being forceful, locking them up once they find them guilty, and what he called it, trial by combat.
That's right.
And you had the president himself, Donald Trump, talking about you can't be weak, you got to be strong, you got to use force, and you got to fight to win. Now, are these candidates for inciting the riot? You've already said that that's on the books already, so they have to write something up for them. It's already on the books, is that correct?
Yes, sir. 18 U.S. Code 2102, definition, U.S. Code law, incite to riot, is or to organize, promote, encourage, participate in, or carry on a riot. So to organize, promote, encourage, as well as participate. So clearly, those three individuals can be prosecuted for the charge of incite to riot.
Now, let me ask you another question.
Yes, sir.
With respect to conspiracy, mm-hmm. I think in every state across America, and certainly in federal law, conspiracy is two or more, is that right?
Yes, sir.
So we're talking about at least three people, and I'm not even talking about his other family members, his daughter, that spoke before them.
Right.
But doesn't that group constitute two or more?
Yes, it does.
Did not that group inspire two or more people to go to the Capitol building?
At this point, I don't even think that's debatable. Now, as I said, I know your questions are rhetorical. I don't even think that's debatable. When you look at the language and then you look at the activity immediately following the language, look at the activity of the people they were speaking to, and that question answers itself.
They spoke before, they said 8,000 people that was there.
Right.
Now, I'm not saying all 8,000 went to the Capitol building, mm-hmm. but they spoke before 8,000.
Right.
They caused an entire riot where thousands of people walked towards the Capitol building.
Right.
So the charges are on the book already. A first-year law student in college can tell you what charges they violated, but you've already pointed out. What's that order again?
The incite the riot?
Yeah.
Yes. It's 18 U.S. Code 2102.
Just in case a prosecutor's looking and he forgot it, you reminded him.
Yes, sir.
It's 1802?
Okay. 2102.
2102. Uh-huh. And they should know what conspiracy is also, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So even figuring things, you got them on inciting the riot and conspiracy.
Right. And as I stated, not only do you look at their words prior to or during a rally, but look at the activities and the actions of the crowd immediately upon hearing them give that charge. So it wasn't as if they waited 2 weeks, a month, 6 months. Right after they gave the charge, the crowd went right to the Capitol building and stormed it as they were encouraged to do.
Right. As a matter of fact, a month earlier, they were told in a tweet by the president, come to D.C. on January the 6th. He says in a tweet, it's going to be wild. Mm-hmm. That's his tweet. It's not our tweet. 100 black law enforcement did not tweet that. It's going to be wild. That wasn't 100 blacks in law enforcement. That was the American president.
Facts.
So he said it was going to be wild. He said, they said as a group, go kick some butt. That's what his son said. You got to kick some butt and I'm keeping it clean.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he said. So you have more than enough evidence on them. Now, when you talking to a crowd of people that's got bats, pipes, they wearing flap jackets, helmets, they having insignias, they having things to say, don't tread on me. That's the Revolutionary War. They having Civil War, MAGA t-shirts on. The Civil War, they continuing the Civil War, North, South. How do you talk to people like that without knowing in advance that people that's got on leather jackets, flight jackets that, you know, or motorcycle jackets and that kind of stuff, wearing all kind of stuff, looking like Attila the Hun? How do you get in front of those people and talk like that and then expect them to go down to the Capitol building and sing Mary Had a Little Lamb? The fleece was white as snow. They not gonna go down there singing. They going down there swinging.
Right. And
these are the people that trapped a police officer, Noel, in a door. Did you see the police officer trapped in a door, screaming?
Yes, sir.
Screaming, hollering.
For help.
They pushed him. What?
For help.
Yeah. They had him in the door and was squeezing the life out of him.
Right, trying to.
That's what inciting people to do.
Exactly.
Now, you can't tell me that those people did not know that they was in the Capitol building, which some of them are saying, I didn't realize that I was inside.
Ignorance, really? Ignorance not excuse.
Right, that's what they said.
Right. But let me interject, Michael, but go back to something that you said regarding the FBI and other agencies' investigation of black organizations and putting them under the microscope. We're finding out, some of us knew in advance, that there's been so much chatter over the internet regarding what these individuals' intentions were, that they were very, very clear on what they intended to do when they got into Washington. There's no reason why the preparation wasn't there. There's no reason why there was a lackluster response by law enforcement agencies responsible for protecting the Capitol building, as well as members of the Senate and Congress, as well as the vice president who was also in the building. So there's no excuse, but we know that race plays a role, because all the time and energy that they give to so-called black extremist organizations, even though the FBI has stated that the number one threat to this nation are these white supremacist organizations, but clearly they get very little attention by law enforcement authorities because they allow this to happen. You know, the president played a role in it, but the law enforcement agencies had a responsibility, and they were warned by a number of organizations around the country, you know, that don't play this particular day low, because we're reading on the internet a whole lot of threatening information, a whole lot of comments as to what they intended to do. It was right out there, right in the open, you know. So that, I'm pretty sure when this investigation goes on, they're gonna take a look at that. And I just say real quick that don't forget the investigation into the invasion of the embassy, I believe it was in Libya, by one of the previous administrations. You know, the Congress and the Senate had exhausted investigations. They claimed that Hillary Clinton played a role and had some responsibility in what happened. The president at the time for not responding in time. Let's see if they have that same energy in regards to these individuals' invasion of the Capitol building. Let's see if they're willing to exhaust as much money and time into investigating what happened, not over in another country, not over in the so-called third world country, banana republic, dictatorial society, but right here in the United States of America. Let's see if they exhaust as much energy as they did into the invasion of that particular embassy where soldiers died, into the invasion of the Capitol building where American citizens and a police officer died right here.
Well, in the last 5 minutes we have, just want to say real quickly that you can tell future behavior by past behavior. He told, him meaning the president, told the Proud Boys to stand back, stand down, and they were there. The Proud Boys were there. The MAGA hats, the Civil War people were there. They had the Confederacy flag there. The Kekistan flag was there. The Oath Keepers were there. Camp Auschwitz group, all these various militias were all there, and they should not get a pass. That was clearly showing that they meant business. When you see these militia groups there scaling walls, brandishing weapons, it should show that they were nothing but serious.
Okay, closing comments, Mike.
Yeah, just want to say for the record that their laws on the books, I don't expect them to be even Steven, but I don't want to hear them acting as if it's so hard to prosecute obvious crimes. These laws have been on the books for centuries, some of these laws. And they have present day laws that cover whatever wasn't there at the origin of the Constitution. So I'm just saying for the record, Giuliani should be prosecuted. President Trump should be prosecuted. Donald Trump Jr., Cruz should be him, Hawley and all of them. McCarthy, all of them should be prosecuted, all these high-powered elected officials. So I say again, black man, black woman, protect the black child, accept your own and be yourself. And remember the African proverb, the axe forgets what the tree remembers.
Right. All right. And ignorance is not an excuse as it relates to the law. I know these prosecutors may look at some of the rioters and say, that looks like my mother, that looks like my grandmother, that looks like my grandfather, that looks like my brother. But that should not be the determinant when they decide to prosecute to the fullest extent of the law. No excuses. Michael, as you stated, is not. They never have any problems with enforcing the law. Vigorous prosecutions when we're talking about a Black or Latino. Let's see how they handle this particular the group, because their mere presence inside of the Capitol it convicts them. They know that they didn't enter the Capitol building the appropriate way. But on behalf of Community Cop, we like to thank our engineers and producers, Nat Woods, Sheila Berry, Veronica Kitt. We like to thank our master producer, Big D, who's here with us today. We like to thank you, our viewing audience, for watching. See you next week, same time, same channel. Knowledge is power. Lenny Lou, I love you. Kitty Cat, Little Mo, I love you. Community Cop family, I love you. See you next Tuesday. Don't forget, knowledge is power. Peace.
We will not bow down to racism.
We will not bow down to
injustice.
We will not bow down to
exploitation. I'm gonna stay.
Come and take a walk with me, cross a walk with me, see what only I can see.
Sisters, check this, watch this.
You in jeopardy. Yo, yo, set me free. Don't hinder me. Let me be.
I'm fighting for freedom. I got the heat in case you need them. A straight soldier. Ain't nobody told ya.
We've been together since I created border. The African border celebration is in order.
My only chance of being free is to fly within me, and it's illegal to kill a freaking eagle.
A bird is never more important than my people. I guess.